Welcome to the Startup Grind.
I'm Alexandra Tonevo. I'm from Startup Grind Sofia. Startup Grind is this international community focused on connecting entrepreneurs to share knowledge, experience, ideas, and friendship. Today we invited Hugh from Getti to share his experience and his knowledge in doing business. Welcome.
Thank you.
Dobro večer.
Of course, we will start first with your background. Can you tell us more about your background, where are you from, and how did you decide to start your own business?
Well, first of all, Alex, thanks very much for having me tonight. So it's interesting for me to be able to come and speak to all of you and share some of the knowledge that I've gained over the last 25 years, particularly the knowledge I've gained in starting Getti. So, where am I from? I'm from New Zealand. I started my business career when I was 19 in Australia. I started a logistics business there. We managed to exit that business in 2002. And then I took some time off, traveled around the world for a while, and ended up on your fine shores in Bulgaria. In 2004, and I really enjoy Bulgaria. It's a great country. I love it here. And I think it was in 2013 I started Getti, and here we are.
Can you tell us a bit more about your family? Were they supportive when you decided to start your own business?
Absolutely. I mean, I'm very lucky. I married a lovely Bulgarian lady, and Vasi has been very supportive of my business throughout. When starting a business early, there's not much time for the family, so she's been a great support. I've got two great kids, two boys, Anthony and Max. They're 7 and 9. The last 3 years, I didn't really get much time to see them in starting a business, but they've been very supportive. They wonder where I am sometimes, but I actually managed to spend some time with them on the weekends.
That's great. I was really curious about your first business. Can you tell us more about it?
Yeah, it was. It's a courier business, so my partner and I started delivering envelopes around Sydney. Back in 1991, it was pretty simple, really. We got a phone call, picked up the phone, and radio on a two-way radio, got a car to go and pick it up, and then deliver it to the next point. We realized fairly quickly that technology was going to help us a lot with the business. So we invested in mobile terminals inside the cars. You've probably seen inside taxis and so forth. But we saw that really wasn't going to take us to where we wanted to go. So we looked at mobile telephone communication as an alternative to two-way radios. And we started buying, you may remember them, they're bricks now, but the Nokia 9110s. You know, these were the greatest phones that were around at the time. Why we liked them, because they had a keyboard, they had the original smartphones. So we gave them to all of our couriers. And one of the biggest problems in the delivery service, and this actually is for all businesses, identifying what the key problem is. And in the courier business was finding out actually who received the parcel. And so we used this technology with an SMS communication to identify who received the parcel. And that enabled us to go to the next stage. You know, we gained a lot of business from this, triangulation system with CDMA technology. And then that took us to the next stage where we had online bookings. Can you imagine that? Back in those days. But ultimately, we sold the business to Australia Post. We built a network in Sydney, Melbourne, Brisbane, Perth, and Australia Post liked our network and our technology and enabled us to exit.
When did you decide to sell the business?
I think after sort of 10 years of grinding away and building the business, I think my partner and I were starting to get pretty tight. And it kind of just happened, really. We after investing so much time in the technology and we'd won some very big contracts, Australia Post, and we'd won a contract with Australia Post. So it kind of worked itself out, really.
Coming to Bulgaria, how come?
That's a good question, because before coming here I had no idea where I was. I had been travelling around the world, and I was looking for an interesting place to live, and I was in London, and I said I was on my way to Turkey. And a friend said, well look, Bulgaria is a great place to go. I said, well, first of all, I said, where's that? And then I jumped on a plane for an exploratory trip and never left.
And you came to Bulgaria, you decided to stay here, and you started a job. What kind of a job was it, and how did this job turn to your business?
Well, I'm not sure if I was actually working when I got here, but time I was, after I sold the business the first time around, I was quite tired, so I wanted to take some time out, and I decided I'd be a freelance journalist. So I was writing some articles at the time, not working too hard, to be honest. And after some time, I met up with some friends, and I had some money to invest, so I started investing in property. In the boom, 2004 to sort of 2007, you know, property business was pretty good. But unfortunately, as we all know, the property market didn't last. And then in 2008, certainly the business and the investments had lost some money. And this is the reality. You know, we don't always win money. And then I started working in the property business, in the property management business, and with a colleague. After that, it was actually at Landmark where I was working. I joined Landmark in 2009, I think it was, where the idea of Getti actually came from. So, how did that happen? Well, it's interesting, you know, for all of us, you know, we're working, we're looking at different things that we do. We always come up with bright ideas, right? And we think, oh, this idea will work. But it was at Landmark, I was managing, I think it was about 200,000 square meters of property, shopping malls and office businesses and the facilities management. And the time the CEO said to me, Hugh, we've got the marketing mandate for a shopping mall. And what a retail park it was called this retail park. He said, do you think, can you have a look at that and see if we can actually make that one work? And I said, okay, good. So it was, I heard a couple of ideas from different marketing people. Again, I was looking in the discovery phase, sort of wondering what actually would bring people to come to a shopping mall? Why would they come? There was lots of marketing ideas about bringing people for events and so forth. But the problem is, to solve is to get people to come and spend money. And that's where Getti came from, is that we wanted to identify the customer, identify what the customer spent, and then so that we could then attract the right customer with the right offer to come and spend money as part of the loyalty program. So that's Getti.
When did the company started? When did Getti started?
We launched, officially we launched in October 2013. The development phase of it, the idea of Getti was in January 2012. I started asking around, looking for some good people to join. I was chatting with one of the guys tonight, I was talking about co-founders. And this, in my opinion, is the most important thing in business, is finding the right co-founders. So in June, my business partner, Costa, he's here in the crowd, and he's a Getty CTO, and having a smart guy, I'm not a technology guy, I'm a sales marketing guy, business visionary, but having a good CTO on board is you know, imperative. So we spent the best part of a year working through the product, as to what we wanted to do, developing it, and then we got to the launch in October. Just to mention, Costa brought on a business partner as well, Stefan Bartolomeo. I don't know if you know him, but that was the key part, is having those guys on board to get Getti forward.
Now we can focus more on the main topic, the team. Tell us more about how did you manage to get together such a good team that you actually developed a very good company, successful company, and you managed to get different kinds of investments with this team.
Well, as I said, you know, starting a business from zero, I think some of you in the room here might know, but starting a business from zero is a challenge. You know, we're all full of lots of ideas, lots of energy, but actually bringing that to fruition is a tricky thing to do. So having the right team that you can work with, that you can bounce ideas off, is priceless. And it's not about necessarily having people of the same mind, because you know we all hang out with the people that we like, right? This is what we do. But having people that actually will confront, argue in a positive way, you know, you talk about positive mental attitudes, negative mental attitudes, but people with the right, that are willing to stand up for what they believe in. You know, we don't want partners in our business that are yes people, we want bad partners that actually can make us think and develop the right sort of product. So having the right team members is for the business is critical, but also in terms of investment is critical as well. When I started Getti, I funded it myself with some seed capital from a couple of other individuals. But I knew when I started the business, I wasn't going to actually have you know, enough to carry the journey through. So, virtually from day one, I was out looking for money. And I went to, it feels like hundreds of people, to be fair. It really does feel like, you know, knocking on so many doors. You get lots and lots and lots of no's all the way through. But the experience in getting those no's makes the next pitch a little bit better, and a little bit better, and a little bit better. So, I think in terms of, you know, what is it, the team as funding-wise, you've got the accelerators here at Bulgaria that looks like a way to raise money. I went to see the guys at 11. We talked to the guys at Launch Hub. I talked with the guys at Avec. And ultimately what happened there is, you know, we got turned down. You know, we our business model wasn't, in their opinion, scalable. So we got shut down. So then the choice was to go back out to private equity. So knocking on lots of doors, making lots of presentations, and finally, you know, we successfully got funded at the end of, was it 2015.
You mentioned that you had two offers for investment, two for 3 offers for investment, but you turned down these offers?
Yeah, I did have 2 offers for additional funding. Certainly one was from quite a wealthy individual to bring in, put in money. The deal at the time is that he wanted a huge chunk of the business. So when you're starting a business, you always think your business is going to make lots of money and it's going to do it really quickly. So when that offer came through in the early part, I just wasn't really comfortable in losing the majority of the business straight away. It just was going to be a very hard pill to swallow. So I knocked that back. Then, as we progressed, I found another couple of guys who, again, in private equity, who wanted to fund the business. But the deal structure was wrong. They put in some preset criteria that we had to meet. By the way, all investors like to do these things. This is what happens, you know, in business. But the risk was too high. Although we believe in what we're going to do, and certainly all of us believe in that we were going to make money, but the chance of the risk of actually losing the business with these basic criteria, I rejected the offer.
You also mentioned that you were going few people to meet the investors, and how did you prepare to meet the investors, and how did you manage to prove that your team is worth investing in?
Well, I think for the first meetings, I think we all thought we knew what we were doing. I think that's probably the starting point. But after you do a few of these meetings, you actually realize that you don't really know. Even though in the experience business I've had, funding for a startup seems to be, it's completely different from all the other funding things I've been involved in the past. There was the promise of making money rather than a business actually making money. So we did, as a team, we all worked together and we prepared our presentations, we prepared our spreadsheets. Of course, the spreadsheets all had wonderful numbers in them. They always looked good, right? Has anyone ever seen a bad spreadsheet? I don't think so. So we did our pitches. Then they failed. We were unsuccessful. So then we said, okay, well, guess what, guys? We've actually got to get better at this. So we all got in the room and we started putting ourselves on videos and looking through different fancy presentation modules and so forth. Because at this particular time in the business, we were already operating, but we realized that we were actually going to run out of money. And that's a pretty scary place to be, I can tell you that. So the pressure was starting to come on. So we were rehearsing stuff and going over and over again. We looked at different templates, to fill out your business plans and to present them. I can tell you, I think my first business plan was about 100 pages long. It's kind of the wrong way to go. Nobody ever reads these things. I realized that the shorter the business plan and the more punchy it was, the better it was. That people actually could if somebody could understand the business in 3 pages, fantastic job. But the other thing I learned pretty quickly, after talking to some of the people that we'd pitched to and said, why didn't you fund us? They said, well, it's you're a good guy, Hugh, but you've got a great young team with you. Let them talk. Let them, be involved in the funding process more. And that was a real revelation to me. Because I thought that with my experience in business, I could actually go out and do it. But the answer here is that it is your team. This is what people are investing in. The first thing that they're investing in is you and your team, the people. It's critical. And then after that is actually the business. As I said before, you never see a bad business plan or a bad spreadsheet, right?
You have experience in managing people and leading people. Can you tell us more about how to hire the right people and what do you really focus on when you hire people in your team?
Yeah, as I said before, when you start your business out, it's about finding people with the right mental attitude and the right approach. I mentioned again, it was positive mental attitude and negative mental attitudes. These are two things that we all have. So when I met the team that we've put together, a lot of it was based on instinct and meeting these guys. I sit down and have a chat with them and see if they would actually fit within the business culture that we had. Working, I think again, we probably all know that working in a small business, we have to multitask, we have to be open, and having a work ethic that it's a 24/7 job to get something off the ground. So I was lucky that, you know, I met some, you know, Costa to begin with. He had some fantastic contacts in the business and colleagues, and we, like-minded people, sort of got together. When I say like-minded people, people with the attitude that they want to actually make something, and believing in themselves, believing in the business. Now, it's one of the mottos I live by: is nothing is impossible. There's no room when starting a business for doubt. And, you know, you go through this experience in funding, you know, and when you get after multiple different rejections, you know, sometimes you just got to wake up in the morning and say, okay, forget about what these people are saying. We've actually got to get through it. And so coming back to hiring of a team is finding those right people, they were instrumental. Hiring people with a positive mental attitude keeps you driving in the right direction right throughout.
What would you recommend to the people that don't have any experience in managing people when they are looking for partners and co-founders and people for their team?
Well, the first thing that you're looking for is about the truth. And you have to be honest with yourself. So, I guess in essence, everybody's got strengths and weaknesses. So when I say about being honest and being truthful to yourself, you've got to focus on if people can actually tell you what their weaknesses are, right? Does anybody like to acknowledge, you know, say, hey, I'm weak at this? No, not really. So, because if we know what our weaknesses are and what our business partners' weaknesses are in the team, then we acknowledge them and then we can focus on the people's strengths. So when choosing your business partners, you have to have the right sort of values. Make sure that the values are the same between the group. In terms of choosing co-founders, I think I was talking to someone tonight, said, oh, you know, how many co-founders should I have? Well, I think it's good to, you know, can you do this on your own? No, I don't think so. I think you're always going to have somebody to bounce ideas off. Is it good to have lots of different co-founders? No, I don't think so either. You know, I think that probably the appropriate number is probably two or three in terms of co-founding a business. Why? Because in business, you may think that everything's going to go well all the way through, but there's always difficult times. So if you've chosen the right business partners with the right values and you guys are on the same page together, that's a great starting point. And then in the dark days, you want to make sure that you've got that honest values together, that you're not going to team up against each other.
What about, let's go back to the investments. What is the worst experience with meeting an investor?
Okay, that's a good question. I think when we knew that we were going to run out of money, we got all fairly stressed about the meeting. I think it was with one of the funds. And you know, when you're under pressure to keep the business going, you've got salaries to pay. It's a lot of stress that goes on. So I think at the time when we were pitching to the fund, the moment when they said, you know, can you explain to us how your business is going to be scalable? And we believed that we actually had a pretty good business and that everybody wanted it. But being unable to actually answer that question adequately in front of the investors and actually being prepared enough to answer those questions, that was we knew that that was complete failure. And the other thing is that the investors, they want to know that you know the numbers. It's you know, even though your spreadsheet might be optimistic, you've got to know the numbers inside out. And you know, you also have a solid plan for growth.
When we talked a few days ago, you mentioned that the idea for Getti in the beginning completely changed now. Can you tell us more about how the transition from the first idea to the one that is done?
Yeah, sure. But as I mentioned before, well, let me tell you a little bit about Getti. Okay, Getti is a loyalty platform today. We wanted to do was create a platform for multi-retailers across the, starting in Bulgaria, multi-retailers connecting to the consumer market. We believed that in the first place was having a system that could actually track what consumers bought by product was going to be pretty special. So, In the business of loyalty, you track three things traditionally. It's recency, frequency, and monetary values. In our software, we had developed a feature that we were able to integrate with particular retail partners that we could actually track the product and brand. So by doing this, we believed that we were able to send messages out to the consumer based on the purchase history. So if somebody bought a particular brand of wine, paid a particular price to it, then they would also be able to do something else, potentially buy an iPhone. So if you're somebody who's spending $100 on a bottle of wine in a restaurant, they could afford to buy a $2,000 phone. So we had all of these different associations, but pretty quickly we realized that just wasn't good enough. Why would the consumer use the platform? Why would the retailer be giving us this data? You know, so it sounds logical now, right? So we didn't always believe that cashback was the golden egg, or the silver bullet, as you might want to say. But developing a cashback system was quite complicated and expensive. So. We wanted to give the consumer exceptional value so that they would join the platform and then use the platform. And the fact is that we went over it time and time again, but we just couldn't work out a way to make it work. So sitting down with my partners, and we were in a room and going, you know, we really need to solve this now. And particularly when you're backed into a corner, somehow something inside sort of says, okay, we have to make this work. So we developed a product, what we call today, it's called Monetti. And Monetti is a virtual currency. So what happens is when you use our mobile app or our card, with a retailer. You earn free money, virtual money. And that was one of the game changers for us at Getti, to be able to create a true loyalty platform. So how does that work? The consumer goes in and buys the product, they pay 100% of the price, but they could be earning 5, 10, 15% in virtual currency that they can spend when you go back to the retailer. So in business, all of these things, everybody has to win. So here the consumer is winning because you're getting free money for doing something that you would ordinarily do. And the retailer was winning because you had to come back a second time to receive your free money. So, and then in terms of what else we had to develop more into was our business analytics. So we figured that we could put two and two together, knowing what people do, how often they buy, and so forth, and attract them. But actually, business analytics is a huge field. So we've spent 3 years now developing our business analytics, and we, are we 25% of the way there? it's a big topic. But we've realized that there's a lot of fancy software out there. Analyzing the processes in the business. So that's where we've changed through to. We also started off the business with another idea where we were giving away free things to people. We thought, okay, everybody likes something for free, right? So we started the business giving away 10 airline tickets from Turkish Airlines to anywhere in the world. Over the first 2 years, we've given away thousands and thousands and thousands of gifts. We were quite good at procuring things from sponsors to give to our consumers. And truly believed that giving something to somebody for free would drive them to use the card. But little did I know, in Bulgaria, everybody thinks these things are rigged, right? If you give away a car, it's going to be given to your friend, right? But and as we progressed in this particular product, it doesn't actually drive people to use the platform. Everybody wants an instant win. They want cash, they want money, and that's what we had to develop. So our product, where we're giving away things, we call it Bulleti. We still have it, but it's much less of a focus for us. Our focus is based on giving away the free money to Manetti, and doing our analytics, and then moving into campaign management, where we can connect the right consumer with the right retailer.
If you have to start all over again now, what would you do differently?
I think I'm at the door. If I had to start again, I would do a lot of things differently. I would do a lot of things differently. When I started the business, I dreamed of having a worldwide loyalty platform business. I even in my first business plan, I think I had 10 countries. So that's where I was starting from. My partners, coming from the software side, they're so used to testing, beta testing everything. And as well, it says, we need to test things. And if I was going to start again, I would be more realistic and I would start smaller. I would start in probably a single retailer, see how that would work with a small community of consumers, and learn from our mistakes there, and then scale from there. Starting the way that we did is expensive, with trying to tackle a whole country in one go, and having another foot out the door to the next country. It doesn't quite work that way.
Was that your biggest mistake, starting big and not testing soon enough, early enough?
Yeah, I think so. I think two mistakes. That's probably one of them. The other one was starting too early. I think that we're always in a hurry to room, thinking about starting a business tonight, today, you want to start tomorrow. But if I look back on it, at the time I was thinking, oh, look, somebody else is going to do this. Somebody else is going to take this idea, and I should actually do it now. It took us still 18 months to get to where we were, but now looking back on it, I probably would have taken another 12 months to lock in the product and have done some testing along the way.
What would you recommend to the guests and the girls that want to start tomorrow?
Take your time. You know, really look at it. Look at it closely. I know you, look, it's probably going to be a fantastic idea and it's definitely going to work. But take your time. Talk to your friends. Ask them if they would do it. Talk to people that you don't know and ask them if they would buy it. Because you've got to make sales, right? This is because if the product's not, people don't buy the product, then you don't make any money. So really take your time, usability testing amongst, as I said, wherever you can. Do things dirty and as cheaply as possible. You can waste a lot of money very quickly.
How is the business going now? And are you planning to expand it outside of Bulgaria soon, or?
Yeah, I think we've got to a point, you know, where we've got some good clients. We've got some clients that, you know, we're growing, and we're hoping, you know, there's always, we haven't made our break-even point yet, but we're getting close to it. It takes time to get through that process, and it always takes much longer than you could even possibly imagine. You know, it just takes time. So we're batting down the hatches now. We're doing a lot of testing on the product because we are planning to go international next year. So we're looking at all the ways that we can improve the product, and that it would almost virtually sell itself into an international market. When we started the business, we did a lot of things manually. We did things that for our customers. So we're looking at now building ways to automate it so that the customer can do, we're talking about the retail customer, can do everything themselves, and making sure that our user experience is where it needs to be. We're not quite there, but we've improved significantly. We look at the customer journey very closely, to make sure that the customer, we're looking at cohort analysis, looking at when people are downloading the app, when they're using the card, and how many people we're losing, you know, whether we can improve those numbers. Because when you go into a new market, you start all the way fresh, all over again. And so we want to make sure that we've got the product and the customer experience bulletproof before going into a new market.
Imagine that we are potential customers of you. How are you going to present your product or service?
I'm not the sales guy for Getti. In terms of a consumer or for a retailer?
In terms of consumer. Yeah, because many of us. Many of the people don't really know the service of Getti.
Okay. So
it's a good time for them to find out about the service.
Well, first of all, I think all of you have probably loyalty cards. I think on average 29 people have 29 loyalty cards, and they're all sitting in your top drawer, right? You never, you know, otherwise you've got a very fat wallet. So the idea of Getti is that it's a single loyalty card that you can use in multiple different places. One of the main reasons why you use Getti, but the other factor is that you can receive money back. See, our virtual currency, one is called Moneti, and one Moneti is equal to one lever. So it kind of makes sense, right? So when you go to the likes of one of our major customers, Technomarket, you can go and use your card there. You go and buy your TV for 1,000 lever, for example, you'll earn 4% in think Manetti. And then, so you've got 40 lever that you can go back and spend in Technomarket on anything. Now, with discount cards, you say, okay, well, look, a discount card's kind of better for us, you know, where you actually save cash. But the fact is that with discount cards, you can't actually use those on promotional items. So you go along and say, oh, look, you know, this Technomarket might be having a 20% sale, but you want to go and get your 25%, you want to use your loyalty card, you can't use it there. So but with Getti, you've already earned your virtual currency, and you can spend it. You could be saving up to 30%, you know, with using the virtual currency wherever you like. It's also quite cool. Our app, download the app. It's on the App Store and on the iOS side. There you actually see the number of Manetti that you've earned in each store, how much you've saved in each store, but also it's good to be used as a point of reference for your expense manager. It lists out exactly what you bought by product. This is with our integrated partners. So, and then on the other side of it, we've branched into shopping malls. So two of our shopping malls is Bulgarian Mall, where we started off with, but the other one is the mall. And the Getti card, when you use it in a participating retailer inside the mall, there's 60 of those retailers that are Getti activated inside the mall, you're earning 2% of that purchase price back. And then that's the second type of Manetti that we have. Then you can go to the store inside the mall and spend that Manetti on products. And these products in there are discounted by 50%. Typically, so you can pick yourself up a new phone, or there's TVs, printers, USB sticks, and all these things at half price on the internet. So that's quite cool. Anybody want to get a card?
We have.
I have, but I didn't mean joke.
See, this is the blend that we're talking about. We disappointed a lot of people. You know, even though we I think it's the numbers is up to, we gave away 14,000 people, you know, 14,000 gifts over the years. We've still got unhappy customers. We have now, we're nearing on 120,000 people have either the Getti card or the mobile app.
The customers in terms of retailers, what are the main challenges in getting them as your customers?
Yeah. I think retailers, when they see something new, I think it's actually all business people, when they see presented with something new, it's scary. It's, you know, if my next door neighbor's not doing it, then I don't want to do it. So bringing a new product to market or a new way of doing things is like, yeah, but I'll just wait and see. So everybody, all the retailers in Bulgaria have done things the same way for so long. If we're giving people a loyalty card that gives you a discount. So, but is that a loyalty card? You know, this is how I've been communicating. If you give somebody a 5% loyalty card, they can only get the 5% or the 10%, but do you have to come back? And the answer is no, it's a discount card. So presenting this to the retailers has been, first of all, the fact that it's new has been a challenge. They wanted to see other people working, see the system working elsewhere. And I think in terms of the adoption of technology, our product, what makes it special is that we're tracking the actual product brand and number of items, kilos of products and so forth, which means that we have to integrate with the retailer's ERP system, and that's been quite tricky because nobody likes to have their open their shirt as such. But people feel that it's opening their shirt, but in fact it's not. All we do is we just receive the same information that you get on a physical printer. So the retailer's giving it away already, but that mindset has been quite tricky to overcome. So we've looked at to overcome that, we had to adapt, and we came up with a web solution, a web-based solution that didn't have to connect with the retailer, and that's enabled us to grow. It's been actually one of the great products that we developed and enabled us to scale. So we can give just about any retailer in the country access to Getti now through the web point.
And can you share with us your motto, your entrepreneurial motto?
Well, it's probably a bit of a cliche, but really, I mean, you know, anything's possible. Never give up. It is a bit of a cliche. I understand, you know, but lots of people will tell you that your idea is don't go. Lots of people will tell you don't bother. Believe in yourself. I mean, seriously, believe in yourself. It's so important. And make sure that to start your business, that you truly do believe in yourself, because there will be dark days, and you've got to get through those. So make sure you believe in yourself.
Any advice is how to prepare ourselves to be confident, even though we hear all the time no?
Is no really no? I think it's just not right now. I think that's in the South. So you get lots of no's when you're selling a product from the new side. And what does that mean? Well, I was chatting actually with one of my team members today, and we were looking at how we can grow and grow the business better. When you're starting off with a business, you develop the business model, and you develop what you actually want to sell. So then you go out and you start selling exactly that. Logical, right? But 3 years down the track, it actually makes more sense that you actually go to your potential customers that you know, first of all selecting ones that you actually believe they would actually buy, and then you just ask them what they want. Much easier, right? You ask them what they want, and then you develop a solution, adapting your business model for that solution. You don't want to make a customized solution for every customer, but you can certainly tweak what you do. So that's the important thing. Really identify what your customers want first.
And our last question. What would you recommend to all the young people that want to start a business in terms of personality, do they need to focus on personal development or focus on a development of the idea?
It's yourself. You got to believe in yourself. Develop yourself. Spend time doing lots of reading. It's important. Discipline. Make sure that you've got a great discipline, a good routine. Routine. You know, people say routine. You know, routine's routine, but a routine is priceless. You know, you get up at the same time each day. Do the things that you need to do. I like to get up early in the morning because that I feel makes me feel good. Firstly, I might be pretty tired actually when the alarm goes off, depending on what time I went to bed. But once I'm up, I've got lots of energy in the morning. I do my best thinking in the mornings. So work out the routine for yourself. Work on you. There's plenty of good books out there that can give you advice. And after you're feeling very confident in who you are and what you're able to achieve, I think the product, developing the product, just sort of comes naturally. Certainly it's not easy, there's a lot of challenges in product development, but just make sure that you're rock solid first.
Do you want to ask questions now? Anybody has questions?
I'll give you the microphone.
Very nice. I have a question. Sorry. I saw a movie some some time ago, it was just a normal Hollywood movie, and one of the guys, he was saying something like, only a stupid man invests his own money. So what do you think about that? Should we go for business by ourselves with our own money, or should we spend somebody else's money?
I've heard that saying too. I don't believe in that. You know, I believe to put my money where my mouth is. You know, I think that's important. But clearly, you know, if you don't have enough money, you've got to find money from somewhere else. I think most investors say it's about blood money. So you've got to actually have some money in there. You've got to feel the pain yourself. And anybody that can actually start a business without 1 cent of their own money, hats off to them. But you might also find it very difficult to get money further down the track.
Can I get one more? Sorry. What is the main difference between having a startup in New Zealand, you said Australia actually, and Bulgaria? What do you find is a major difference?
Well, first of all, in Bulgaria, there's some very impressive, smart people. And even in Australia, it's likewise too, but the community here is smaller, and I've been very impressed with the talent that's here in building a business. But on the other side of things is that how business is actually done in this country is significantly different. So presenting a product with all its own merits is much, much more difficult. People are not as open to trying something new and embracing the technological differences. So that's a big challenge, and certainly the team and I believe that if we can make it work in Bulgaria, we can make it work anywhere.
Thank you.
I have a question. Maybe I can do it without microphone, just to practice. Hugh, you said that when you mentioned going through dark days maybe about 3 or 4 times during the conversation, and then I was wondering, how does this business fit within your personal value system, or what gives you the motivation in the dark days to go on? What world problem are you trying to solve with this consumer retailer connection? Like, what is your threat? How do you feel satisfied?
I think when you're under a lot of pressure to get the business working, and when I was referring to the dark days, it was about the product not working, running out of money, these things. That does put a lot of stress. I'd say that I'm a very positive person, but getting out of that position was reaching really deep inside myself and my physical character. That's why I said to you again, to know yourself and feel confident in who you are. Is your question, you're saying, how do you carry through those days through it? It's having an eternal belief in yourself. I know it's easy to say, but you truly actually have to do it. And that's what got me through all those times. Because being a CEO, there's no one else to blame. So you actually carry those things yourself.
You mentioned values 3-4 times. Values that brought you together with some people. Can you share us your value system somehow? That how you choose certain people to work with you, your core team, and how you reject some others.
Well, I think.
So which are these values reserved for you?
Yeah. Okay. Well, values. I mean, it's integrity. You know, you integrity is a word that I don't use lightly. There's a lot of people that talk and do no action. There's a lot of people that like to misrepresent the facts. And the values, one, the, values of honesty and integrity are very high in my books. And I'm very lucky to have business partners that are of the same values. So when you're selecting your team, if they're your values, then that's what you do. If you've got other values, then you know, it's you can work it out yourself. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
First time, did you do any research about the competition in the market? Or?
Yeah, we looked at if there was anything like it in Bulgaria. That was the first place to start, and there wasn't, and there isn't just yet. So we've got the luxury of being the only card or loyalty platform in the market that's like ourselves. We looked internationally. To look at the solutions that were there. Nectar card in the UK was one of the ones that we looked at quite closely. We also looked at Tesco's model, which was one of the more successful loyalty cards and systems for the supermarket. So we looked quite closely over it. And you're right, you know, you can't do enough research. You know, some things, do you need to reinvent the wheel? No. You can take some good ideas, tweak them, turn them into your own, and you need to be very knowledgeable. I mean, if we're building a business, it needs to be scalable. You need to go and take it internationally. So you need to know what's available, not just here in the country, but what else is in other countries.
Other questions?
So you said that it's important to realize what people want and just give it to them. And I just want to, I mean, it sounds simple, but I just want to ask you, do people really know what they want?
Do you guys know what you want? It's a good question, it's a great question. And the answer to that is no. I've sat at many meetings and said to them, well, what do you want? People sort of said, well, you know, I kind of want some more customers. What does loyalty mean to you? Yeah, people coming back, you know. And so what happens is, going through that process of discovery is not just asking the straight question, you're actually asking a number of questions to get to the point. Because people don't give it up easy, or they don't even know how to give it up. That information. So.
And I got one more. Would you say developing in, let's say, London, because I understand that you've lived there, is easier than developing in Bulgaria, for example, or is the right location a major factor for success?
It depends on what you want at the time, because there's two sides. One is having a big market, and having lots of people, and so that you can try to attract 1% of the market and it makes a huge difference to you, or you have to attract 20% of the market for you to get the same result. So if that's one side, the other side is developing a product is expensive. IT development is expensive, human resources, it costs money. So in Bulgaria, fortunately, I'm not sure if salaries keep going up in IT, but anyway, in terms of cost, typically it's much cheaper to develop here in Bulgaria. And any mistakes cost you less, marketing costs and so forth. So it's a good place to start the business, iron out all the problems that you have. Everyone has problems. Again, that's the honesty part. We're all going to have problems, we just have to work out how to solve them. And Bulgaria is an awesome place to do that. But then, in terms of scalability, it's never going to be the place that's actually going to make you the fortunes that you might dream of.
Thank you. Thank you, Hugh. It was very nice to have talked with you. And now we all want to express our gratitude. And now we continue with the networking part. If there are some more people that want to ask you more questions, now is the time to ask questions. And we have this board. If you want to write down your contacts, if you are looking for something or offering something, it could be contacts, ideas, knowledge. Look, if you are looking for co-founder or anything, this is a great place, great tool actually to use. Thanks again, Hugh.